everybody, and welcome back to our series of companion guides to the Wheel of Time. These videos are designed to be watched along with each chapter of the book of the Wheel of Time. Like the previous video, this video will be split into two parts. The first section will be a simple recap of the chapter, and will be spoiler-free for anything that comes later in the series. This section is designed for those reading through the books for the first time, and will include a recap of the story as well as some visuals, some maps, and some pictures to help you understand what you just read. It's perfect to read after finishing a chapter. The second section will contain major spoilers for the rest of the series. There we will get into foreshadowing for the story, unanswered questions from the chapter, general Easter eggs, and some analysis of the themes and concepts from the chapter, as well as some general thoughts that go beyond non-spoiler discussion. This section is designed for those who are rereading the series and want companion information to accompany their reread. You'll see a spoiler warning pop up, and you will have ample time to change off the video once we get there if you have not finished the books yet. Make sure if you are a new reader not to read any of the comments on this video, as there will very likely be spoiler-filled comments in the comment section. You can also find timestamps in the video description that will take you directly to the spoiler section or the non-spoiler section. These videos are sponsored by Audible.com, and you can find a link in the description of this video where you can get a free audiobook, great for listening to the Wheel of Time as well as reading. So let's go ahead and hop right on into the recap of the second prologue to the Eye of the World, titled Ravens. The chapter opens with 9-year-old Egwene Alvear carrying water from the winespring. She is with many of the other villagers from Emmons Field in a clearing called Widow Einol's Meadow in the southwest of Emmons Field. They are all there as today is the day that sheep are being sheared in the village, and the entire village population has shown up to take part in the shearing. Egwene has been assigned to the task of bringing water to the men and women working in the field. Now, she's decided to take her job very seriously, and she's determined to be the best water carrier ever. While filling her bucket, Egwene notices a raven acting very strangely and watching the men work. She continues on carrying her water, and a boy 2 years older than her named Kenley Ahan tells her that she won't be able to play with the other kids this year and tells her to get on about her work, which annoys Egwene greatly. Now, he's doing this because next year he'll be able to join the older boys in shearing the sheep, so he believes that he has some authority over her, and she doesn't like him giving her orders. She attempts to give him the look that she's seen other women give to men, but it doesn't have the desired effect, and so she continues on. Now, she continues carrying the water through the crowd of people and offers water to everybody who wants it. She takes care to avoid her four sisters in the crowd because they treat her like a baby and she doesn't like that. Now, Egwene makes her way back to refill her bucket and spots the village blacksmith, Master Luhan, talking to Khan and Jocelyn Abara, the parents of Perrinabar. Now, she isn't sure what they're talking about, but she notices another girl named Cilia Cole staring at Perrin, and Egwene immediately grimaces as Cilia is staring at it. Egwene then notices another raven looking in their direction and comments to herself that they are everywhere today. Now, as Egwene looks in that direction, Adora Abara asks Egwene why she's staring at Perrin. And Egwene resents that Adora thought that Egwene was staring at Perrin, and so she makes a rude comment to her. Egwene then leaves to look for Perrin after this exchange, but he's gone, so she continues to the river to refill her bucket of water. Now, after refilling her bucket, Egwene comes across the village wisdom, Mistress Baran, and her apprentice Nynaeve Almira. They are tending the wounds of Billy Conger, who had wounded himself with a set of wool shears. Again, Egwene notices a number of ravens staring at them, and she thinks it's extremely unnatural that they're just watching, not trying to get food. Egwene decides to ask Mistress Baran about the ravens, but before she can, Nynaeve asks Egwene if she has work to do, and Egwene reluctantly goes back to delivering water. Egwene continues delivering water and overhears her sister Elisa and another woman talking about why Elisa's hair isn't allowed to be braided yet. And when Elisa notices Egwene, she takes her frustration out on Egwene, admonishing her and telling her that the grown-ups were working here and that she should leave. Egwene goes back again to refill her bucket and decides to look for Perrin and Matt Cawthon. She eventually finds them with some other boys, including Randall Thor. Everyone in the village has told her that one day she will marry Rand, and she wonders if what kind of husband he's going to be. The boys talk about their futures and some talk of going on adventures. Egwene muses to herself that she would love to go on adventures. The boys are about to get back to work when Daniel Lewin tells the boys that the mayor wants to see them. She decides to follow them and find out what the mayor, who is her father, wants them for. When they all get there, the mayor is working, but he tells them that they have all worked hard and that they have earned the reward of a story. The boys ask for stories about Trollocs and false dragons, But Bran says that he doesn't know any stories like that and asks Tam Althor if he will tell a story. Tam is Rand's father. Now Tam tells them the story of how the dragon led the 100 companions to Sheol Gul and sealed the boar on the Dark One's prison. Perrin asks Tam what a dragon is, and Tam doesn't know, but they all agree that it sounds fierce. Now, after the conclusion of the story, the boys get back to work, and so does Egwene. But as she's heading back to get more water, she notices more ravens staring at her. She decides not to be distracted and puts her thoughts back to being the best water carrier ever. We then get a bit of flash forward as the chapter gives us the narration that Egwene carried water the following year, but moved on to helping with food the year after. She gives herself the new goal of being the youngest girl in the Two Rivers to get her hair braided. She stops listening to adults tell stories, but she still likes to read of distant lands. So now we're going to move on to the spoiler-filled section. Please click off the video at this point if you have not finished the series, as we'll be doing a complete deep dive into the rest of the books, and it's going to cover basically all the way to the end. I'll give you a couple more seconds, but again, you have been warned. Now, with foreshadowing in the Raven's prologue, we don't have any major events that are necessarily foreshadowed, but what we do get is glimpses into the future character arcs for some of our main characters. For instance, the chapter comes from Egwene's point of view, and we get to see her inner ambition and desire to be the best at everything she does. She wants to be the best water carrier ever, and at the end of the chapter states that her desire is to be the fastest girl to get her hair braided in the Two Rivers. This attitude and drive is what later helps her become the youngest Ammerlin Seat ever, and one of the most powerful women alive. It also gets her in trouble from time to time. Now we see a number of other small indications of the futures of the boys. For instance, Rand says that he wants to be a king, which he later essentially becomes the king of the world as the Dragon Reborn. Matt wants to run off and live without working, a philosophy that he later attempts to follow. Perrin asks questions during Tam's story about a dragon, showing insight in his drive basically to understand things. We also see a conversation between Perrin's parents and Master Luha. Don't know that this is explicitly about Perrin apprenticing as a blacksmith, but it certainly seems like that was the topic, so we may be seeing the beginning of his apprenticeship. There's also some additional foreshadowing or small plants of information, I guess, that we'll learn more about later. For instance, we see Nynaeve as the apprentice wisdom to Mistress Baron. Egwene talks in her head about the mysterious death of the previous apprentice to the wisdom, strongly implying that she died of channeling sickness, something that Nynaeve had survived after healing Egwene. We also see signs that Nynaeve can channel because Mistress Baron appears upset that Nynaeve, when she was tending to Billy Conger's wounds, that the wound wasn't like instantly healed. This implies that Nynaeve has done miracle work before with healing. Another of the pieces of foreshadowing is the ravens themselves. Obviously, their presence, as well as their behavior, imply a nefarious purpose, and we later learn that it was not just superstition that ravens can be used as spies for the Shadow, but that that's real. Now let me hit some very small Easter eggs within the chapter to our time and our world. These aren't direct references to our age, but rather things that we would be familiar with. During Tam's story about the sealing of the boar, he briefly mentions the Age of Legends and what it was like. He tells the kids of towering buildings, taller than the White Tower, as tall as mountains. And now these are obvious references to what we would call skyscrapers. We currently build buildings that are thousands of feet tall. The White Tower is roughly 600 feet tall, which is certainly a large building, but it would barely be in the skyline of a major city today, let alone in the Age of Legends. Another reference during his story to the Age of Legends was vehicles that could travel faster than horses on the ground and in the air, and that they were powered by the One Power. These are references to cars and planes, but what I've always thought was really interesting is the reference being to being powered by the One Power. How many problems in our society would be solved if we had an unlimited power source, rather than using non-renewable resources? The Age of Legends seems to have come about because the One Power could solve most of those issues, including the need for fuel for cars and planes. Lastly, let's talk about some general thoughts about the chapter and a question. It's often said that one of Robert Jordan's strengths as a writer is his use of the unreliable narrator, and this chapter has a great example. Egwene believes Tam to be wrong in his story because he says that the Forsaken were once Aes Sedai. She knows that some of the Forsaken were men, so she thinks Tam was wrong because, in her mind, only women can be Aes Sedai. Now, she thinks this because, in her world, only women can be Aes Sedai. But during the Age of Legends, both men and women served as Aes Sedai. We also see Perrin's family during the Raven's prologue, something that we don't see in the rest of the books, other than learning that they were killed off-page. I think, to a degree, the inclusion of Perrin's parents and his sister in this scene was meant to humanize them, at least to the extent that later in The Shadow Rising, when they're killed, it has some more weight. Another thing worth noting here is that this prologue was written long after the first book was released. Eye of the World was originally released in 1990, while Ravens was only released as part of the Eye of the World re-release that came out in 2002. At that time, there was a push to market the books to a young adult audience, so they split Eye of the World into two parts, and Ravens was included as an additional prologue. Now, what is great about this is I believe it solves some of the problems from the original release. The Dragonmount prologue has always been somewhat divisive among new readers, as it kind of seems out of context to the rest of the book and somewhat confusing. Ravens does a great job of adding some context with Tam's story of Luz Theron sealing the Boar. Now, given that this is meant to be read directly after Dragonmount, we now have some idea of what happened to Luz Theron prior to that if we read them one after another. So it does give some context. Lastly, for unanswered questions from Ravens, the main one is this. The theme of the chapter is Raven spying on the boys and on Egwene some 7 to 8 years prior to the first chapter of the book, and that the Ravens were watching them all. Now, why would the Shadow have known this early to look in the Two Rivers? And if they knew who to watch, why didn't they act sooner to find Rand and the other Tavirin boys? It just seems kind of oddly specific that the Shadow would be spying on them this much before the start of the story. So what unanswered questions do you have from the chapter? What bits of foreshadowing or themes did I miss? Leave those in the comments of the video. Make sure to like the video and subscribe to the channel to be updated when I post more Wheel of Time content. You can follow all of these book read-through videos by following the playlist for the reread, and you can binge them all in a row. Check out the whole series and the articles that accompany these videos on thegreatblight.com, and check out the video series sponsor audible.com to get a free audiobook by heading to www.audibletrial.com/Nablus. Sign up for the trial and get a free book. Guys, thanks for watching. Until the next one of these, peace out.
Tinker in the kitchen with a job of work to do. Mistress up above, slipping on a rope of blue. She prances down the staircase, a fancy oh so free. Crying, Tinker, oh dear Tinker, won't you mend a pot for me?